Sorry, this is just not working. Okay. Okay, the benefit again is to showcase strength, kind of the focus of being stronger together. Maybe focus on specific industries that look like they're coming out similarly. Have a clearly defined plan and be viewed as a competitive region. Flow of dollars and economies of sale are also benefits to this document. So let me know if you ever want to add anything. Okay. Okay, so the way we wrote the grant is divided into three tasks. The first task will be to gather all of the current SEDS documents. We'll hire a consultant to do this with the assistance of OI, the ICE office, as well as the STED Commission. And then we'll conduct a thorough analysis of the existing tribal SEDS documents, preparing side-by-side comparisons to identify common themes and potential priorities. The deliverables for this first task is a summary review report. Task two will then be to prepare the action plan and the SEDS document, and then develop strategies. Develop strategies to understand, utilize, leverage access to project financing options, including utilizing underutilized funding mechanisms such as opportunity zone designations, new market tax credit, COVID economic recovery funding, capital stacking, and use of public-private partnerships. The action items will be to hold off a kickoff meeting with NADC program staff, ICE, and the STED Commission. Work with all of the commission members to coordinate, facilitate meetings with tribal planners and tribal leadership, and schedule and facilitate bi-weekly meetings with NADC project staff, ICE, and STED to present draft strategies. So I know and understand, you know, that we run into these same kind of barriers when we're trying to assist tribes with developing some of their projects. And the biggest barrier we run into is the lack of, shovel-ready projects. So this really could help us to really identify some of those projects so that we can utilize the opportunity zone funds and the funding that's listed here. The deliverables for this task will be the summary of the meetings, the surveys, and the biweekly meetings, and of course, actually the SEDS document and action plan.
So Mary, this is Maria. Going back to that task too, just so the STED Commission and any of the tribal planners that are on the call and in the room, NADC is gonna hire, if they get this grant, it sounds like they've set aside some other dollars in case they don't get the EDA planning grant, but they're gonna hire a consultant to do this work and to take all the SEDS, all of the tribal SEDS, because each of you have one with the exception of Little Shell, and analyze it. And so the part that I'm still a little bit unclear, but we'll be talking about in these meetings, is after they analyze what these SEDS documents say, we're gonna have community meetings across Indian Country and Montana. But I'm not sure what the goal of those community meetings are yet. And maybe you guys don't have the answer. Maybe that's in more detailed in the grant. But do you know, I mean, like what, if we had a community meeting in Browning or in Ronan or at Harlem, or Hayes, what would we be asking the community?
I would think that you would pull out from that SEDS plan from that reservation, kind of what their priorities are, compare it to what some priorities are with the other reservations, and you want it to be a focused community meeting, right? So you want to come in and say, this looks like this is a priority for a few of the reservations. What are your thoughts on it? What is your feedback on it? I don't think you'd want to go in and not have some focus and not have some idea of what on some specific strategies that you want to come out of that. So that's how I would do it, because there's a quick turnaround. So we can't have probably several community meetings to try to flesh that out. We're going to have to flesh that out based on what the plans say and what we pull from it that looks like there's some similar strategies. Is that?
Good answer.
Okay. Is that answer your question?
Yeah, I mean, the we're going to go to the communities with all of these things fleshed out and basically just get their thoughts about it.
Yes.
Okay, got it.
Okay. Any other questions?
Well, because, oh, Cheryl's got her hand raised.
Okay. Hi. Just so, and I know you must know the process of SIDS, that's our job as well at the local level to have these community meetings and to bring them to the council and then have the council meeting to have their priority list is in there. I don't know that you would view this as a duplication, or is this after the fact that the SIDS has already been approved by both the council and the EDA organization? And then knowing that we have to do this every year because we have, you know, the tribal elections. So the priorities change with each sitting government of elected council members. And so I just didn't know if this was going to be considered a duplication or if there could be something negative coming out of it so that we're bringing up some, you know, the priorities of a previous council versus a sitting council. And that's just some of the things that we encounter. So I just wanted to put that out there.
I've been thinking about that too, Cheryl. It does make sense that you've already done these to prepare your SIDS. Maybe what this one would focus on is the regional, is the, like a region-wide industry or focus. Mm-hmm. Mm-hmm.
Like, I'll give you an example. This is something I've been talking about for the last 6 or 8 months. It's like, if we look at all of the tribal SEDs and what bubbles up is, let's say tourism, you know, they want help marketing, they want help branding. So can we pull in some of the state resources? Can we pull in federal resources to help the tribes that want this around marketing or branding or content development to bring resources to what they're saying in their SEDs? That's just an example that's in my head. There's probably a lot of other examples out there.
See, I find that really useful, utilizing the document in that way, because if you're trying to compare or I guess collect information from everybody's and find the common thread, you know, that we all need, then that makes sense. You would use that common thread and then find us dollars to hire those engineers and architects that have to develop PERs and, you know, PARs to build a long-term care facility or something, because that's the struggles we run into, or even environmentalists to do, you know, as you all know, if you're using trust land to build a building, we have to have environmental clearances. And so that goes through BIA. And so we have to go out and hire contractors that has that capability to write an EIS or an EA or a categorical exclusion or whatever. So that's where I find it most beneficial to just help us find, you know, those type of services.
Yeah, and I think this is Leonard. So that information will be put into this submission of the SEDS to EDA again, you know, for implementation. So these community meetings are really important developing the strategies for the SEDS grant. So like what you said, we do have a really short turnaround on this. So. And, you know, if this doesn't get funded, I think Maria mentioned that we do have some other funds that we could use for this. You know, this first round for the planning is a small amount of grant support. So, you know, it's just getting ready for the next round, the implementation phase. Mm-hmm.
Yeah, so I want the STED commissioners and the tribal planners, economic development folks on the call to understand, you know, when we basically contact you and say, we're doing this regional SEDS, we'd like to host a community meeting, that this is what we're talking about and this is why, and we're hoping that you're going to be able to help us put together these meetings. And to talk to the community about what this regional SEDS says. So I wanted to stop there and see if anybody in the room had any questions about that portion. We have Richard in the room. I'll put it on mute and we'll give him the speaker.
Is somebody going to speak, or do you want me to keep going, Maria?
No, it won't. This is going. I think this is going to add to it, and you know, it'll be a regional SEDS document. So like I said, you know, if Rocky Boy, let's say Rocky Boy has infrastructure and Crow has infrastructure and Fort Belknap does, and that bubbles up out of this regional SEDS document, then the idea is that NADC, along with the state, we're going to try and find some financial resources to help with those infrastructure issues. That's just one example. So it's not going to infringe on what you guys are currently doing with your SEDS.
On the funding portion.
Does. Yeah, and it wouldn't. This is a planning grant, this first one that NADC has applied for. It's a planning grant. And matter of fact, when I talked to EDA, the Denver rep, she thought it was a really good plan. And you know, to have a regional document, they don't really at a regional level know or have this information. So phase one is to do the planning. Phase two would be looking for funding for implementation of regional projects. Does that answer your question? Not really.
So I think his question is, will this compete with our individual tribal SEDS? And it sounds like it won't. Does that clarify it?
Yeah.
Okay. So this is Leonard again. Could I just make a comment? So we get inquiries from large companies that want to approach the tribes in regards to ag projects manufacturing, for example. I mean, there's a real need for manufacturing that tribes could fulfill. And these projects could even be done between the tribes themselves, you know, infrastructure opportunities and those kinds of things, those are the kinds of things that could come out of this, collaborative effort, regional collaborative effort. I know we're being approached by a company for hemp, and I'm sure the tribes are as well. They're looking for a lot of ag related resources for that purpose, and you know they would provide the financing for it too. But you know, first you got to have the data, and you got to have you've got to have something that's shovel ready or investment ready. So hopefully this would help.
Are there any questions from the commissioners? Okay, go ahead, okay. Mary.
Thank you. Okay, the last task would prioritize the projects for phase two implementation. That would also be through the meetings with NABC, ICE instead, to review task one, the summary review document, and the SEDS and action plan to build consensus around top priority areas. The idea is to identify the top three or four projects for statewide initiatives, and maybe an additional 1 to 2 projects for local initiatives based on respective tribal jurisdictions. So task three deliverable is the prioritized action plan document that would then move us forward into phase two, which would be implementation. Any questions on that task?
Cheryl, your hand is raised. Is that just from previous?
Sorry about that. It is from previous. How do I get rid of it?
How do I unraise? I don't know.
I have a constant questions, as you know.
I barely have more brain up. I can't help you.
Cheryl, under reactions, it says raise hand and lower hand.
Got it.
Okay. So the timeline and next steps. So we've already issued an RFQ for a consultant. The responses were due on Monday. Again, Sue's out of town until tomorrow. So as far as I know, we got one in. I'm not sure if we got any more in. She'll be able to answer that more when she gets back. We'd like the project to start on December 1st. And as it's been mentioned a couple of times, we haven't heard back from the EDA. We've heard some positive feedback, but we didn't get anything official. And the guy from EDA is elk hunting. So we probably won't hear back from next week. Either way, NADC has secured some other funding to get this done because it's so important to move forward with this that, you know, we'd like to get it done, whether they fund it or not. However, the EDA implementation application is due in February. That's the big one, and that's the one we do want to get secured. In order to do that, this document, we have to get that done pretty quickly. December, January turnaround. So that's what the timeline looks like. I just want to really emphasize that we don't really want to wait whether we get funded by EDA or not. We're moving forward either way. So we just want to make sure everybody knows that. It's a priority. We feel like it's a huge priority. And you know, you can't sit around and wait for grants all the time. We've managed to kind of sidestep that if it doesn't get funded. Although, like I said, we have heard some positive feedback. So we're anticipating we're going to get funded. Mm-hmm. Just haven't heard the official word yet.
So Mary, just for clarification, it sounds like we're going to do this with or without EDA funding in December and January, and yes. then have our action plan, which we'll use for phase two implementation in February?
Yes. Any other questions on this?
Mary, can you repeat that? I didn't have the, I have to turn the volume up and down when people are talking.
Oh, sorry. We were just re-emphasizing the fact that with or without EDA, we'll move forward with this. So we just don't want everyone to think that we're waiting on funding to get this done. We've prioritized it and we'll move forward either way. However, we do understand that EDA is taking a serious look at this, and we've heard some positive feedback. So we're anticipating we'll get it. We just haven't heard either way, and we'll move forward either way. The phase two is the one we want. So we have to get some work done and really expedite that in order to be ready for that application in February.
Okay, any questions from the commissioners? So we need to keep this front of mind for those biweekly meetings that we're committing to. So appreciate your efforts on this. Thank you.
Hi, this is Cheryl. I just wanted to thank you folks as well, because we've worked with NADC in the past and they've been very, very helpful. They've also included us in grants, which we've received from USDA, their services for grant writing. That's actually helped kick off our telecommunications project. And they're just a great resource. And thank you folks for taking this on. I think it's excellent that you're looking forward to helping us at the regional level to ensure that we have professional services available to us.
Thank you, Cheryl.
Yes, I'd just like to thank everybody for allowing us to do this presentation. I apologize for Sue Taylor not being here, but hopefully you got all your questions answered. Thank you.
Thank you, Leonard. Thank you, Mary. Did you have something, Scott?
Yeah, my only question would be on these 2 week scheduled meetings here. My question would be on these 2 week scheduled meetings. Do we know exactly what we're going to cover, or is there just going to be updates? Because sometimes if it turns into just a general update meeting, we don't get things done. So I would suggest that there's a cadence for what we're doing in these meetings, what's going to be accomplished, whether, yes, there's an update, but then there's some action that's expected that advances. So each one of those meetings should be an advancement to be able to get to that next stage of the project rather than just an update. So there needs to be understood what decisions need to be made, what challenges are there, what actions need to be made. Let's say we're not getting cooperation in a certain area or whatever, so that there's actually a functional set of actions that happen after each meeting, as opposed to leaving the NADC people trying to scramble to solve problems if they're not getting the support that they need on their side. So I think we need to be responsible to be able to help them from our side as well. So that would be my suggestion for how you're going to do these updates. There needs to be a real progression.
Oh, agreed. There's such a quick turnaround. There's no doubt that it has to be structured, very structured meetings. So I agreed with that.
We'll be working close with Maria.
And I think, yeah, that will come out. Probably the format I would think would come out in those kickoff meetings. Maria, would you agree?
Yes, for sure.
Okay.
All right, very good. Well, thank you for that presentation, and we look forward to working with you all.
All right, thank you so much. Have a good rest of your day.
Thank you.
Thank you, have a good day.
So our next speaker here is, we're just setting him up, Jason, with the Great Falls Development Authority. We're going to put him online. So just give us a minute to get him situated.
I did bring some marketing materials. Our CEO would say, the opportunity, you need to promote yourself. So maybe we'll just pass these around. And then anyone who wants a business card of mine.
Okay.
Maria knows how to get a hold of me. If you're okay with it, I'll take my notes up to be better heard.
Yes, they can see me. Good deal. I don't think I know everyone in the room. I know a good number of people, and of course, I don't have my glasses on. Can I just get a read of the room since I don't have my glasses on? I know Maria. Yes. Hi, Ray. Which one? Okay. Nice to meet you. Shelley's the chairwoman
of the CSKT. Okay. And of the commission.
Okay. I know of the director.
Brian Atkins, I'm a Global Shell Tribe.
Okay.
Clancy Stevenson, first vice chairman of Global Shell Tribe.
Okay.
Joel Gray, chairman of Global Shell.
Daniel, we've met before as well. And then there's some people online. I can't see who's online. I should have worn my glasses.
Can we have our online folks introduce themselves to Jason, Cheryl, and Sean?
Sure. This is Cheryl Rivas. I'm the Blackfeet Tribe's planning director here in Browning, Montana.
Cheryl, could you do that again? I didn't hear you.
Yeah. My name is Cheryl Rivas. I'm the Blackfeet Tribe's planning director here in Browning.
Thank you, Cheryl.
Hello, this is Sean Rilbert, and I represent the Crow Tribe and Little Bighorn College in the Ag Department.
That's it?
That's it.
Thank you. And everyone can hear me okay. I know there's echo. Okay, well, Billy asked me to come and say hello to everyone, and I think I'm representing the entire state of Montana's Small Business Development Center program. So I will get into that, but I'd like to just first introduce myself, the organization, the host organization I work for, and what we do. The first thing my name is Jason Nitschke. Some people, including my mother, cannot pronounce my last name correctly, so it's Nitschke. I'm one of the vice presidents at Great Falls Development Authority, and I've been our regional director of our Small Business Development Center program since 2014. Some of you may know Rebecca Engham, who is my predecessor. She's now with Great Falls Montana Tourism. I've been with GFDA now for 7 years. So I can advance my own, or you're going to advance me?
You want to take control?
Yeah. Doesn't matter to me.
He's just online on my iPad. So
okay. So I'll just give a brief introduction to what Great Falls Development Authority is. GFDA is an economic development organization. We serve the 13 county region of the Golden Triangle. Some of the things that we do, I can't remember what's the next slide. GFDA is a 501c3 EDO, 13 county region of the Golden Triangle. We're a CDC, which means we have High Plains Financial, the SBA 504 loan program. We're a CDFI, and I think at this point we have 9 or 10 different sources of loan funds. In essence, what that means is GFDA has gap and bridge funds to help fix and move along stuck projects. We provide project and regional advocacy for the region. We do business attraction, we do talent attraction for the entirety of the region. And then we also provide business technical assistance. what types of business technical assistance. The question Billy asked me to address here is, what is the Small Business Development Center? Just a quick show of hands, familiarity with the SBDC program, yes or no? Okay. For those who don't know, the Small Business Development Center is a federally funded resource partner of the US Small Business Administration. We receive basically, according to this graphic, which is the data I pulled, based on our current contract, 29% of our program funds come from the federal government, 22% comes from the Department of Commerce, and then GFDA is well overmatched in providing the service for our core contract. We also have a contract that is funded through the CARES Act. That will come to a close at the end of this calendar year. Currently, we have 3.5 FTE within our SBDC program, primarily servicing Glacier, Teton, Tule, Pendere, Cascade, Judith Basin, and Fergus. I could probably say that fast, but I'm not going to because I'd probably miss one. So that's 7 of the 13 counties the GFDA covers within the region. The SBDC program is the largest organization of business advisors in the United States. Any corner of the country, including the US territories, there is a business advisor for free that can provide technical assistance to entrepreneurs starting, growing, and expanding. In Montana, there are 10 centers with the lead center at Commerce, 19 total business advisors currently. Again, we have 3.5 FTE in the Great Falls office. What do we do? Why do we do it? No cost advisory support. We coach, counsel, advise, and train. Some of our trainings that do have overhead costs, we do charge for some of those. I have a QuickBooks class that I'm facilitating on Friday. We have to pay the instructor, and we buy people lunch. So we charge to help to cover some of those costs. We can also use generated funds to offset our match obligations to DOC and the SBA. The majority of what we do is provide business and strategic planning. Some of this is going to overlap with NAMIS for sure. Loan packaging assistance is one of our most common requests for assistance. We do general entrepreneurial development. What does that mean? A lot of people come in and they'll call and say, hey, I don't know what I don't know. Can you help me? And then we'll help to strategize, prioritize, and then give action steps, usually distilling it into 3 action items that someone then completes during a month-long period. They come back, as the director referred earlier, updates, and then we make progress on whatever the next thing is. I wrote those notes down, by the way. And then a lot of what I personally do is transition assistance, helping businesses go from one owner to the next. So we do have some generalists on staff. We do have some specialists on staff. Rich Gannon, who works in Cut Bank and primarily works with our rural-based entrepreneurs and our startups, comes to us with a marketing background, a web development background. And so he primarily, his subject matter expertise working with entrepreneurs, he teaches how to do e-commerce. He teaches how to design a marketing strategy. He teaches people what are the procedural elements for starting a business. He primarily works with those types of businesses, primarily in our rural locations. Most recently, Rich taught a website bootcamp in Lewistown with our partners at Snowy Mountain, Snowy Mountain Development Corporation. We are currently looking to hire, not that I'm looking in the room for a new employees, but we are currently looking to hire a content marketing specialist within our SBDC who works primarily with businesses on content marketing, content generation. I think you were just talking about this. And then I work on financial matters, HR matters, operational efficiencies, and that, how do I get my business to the next level, second stage. We're currently working on rolling out a peer-to-peer CEO mentoring program for second stage companies. We'll do that in rural communities with rural entrepreneurs, and then in Great Falls with Great Falls-based entrepreneurs. So we can do some peer-to-peer mentoring. So that's kind of an overview of our center.
I wanted to make a comment if I can.
Sure, go ahead.
I think you need to put yourself on mute. So I just wanted to comment. Luke is on the line, who is our entrepreneur specialist, but the Great Falls Development Authority and Jason and his staff in particular have been very good partners for our Native American Business Advisor program. And you know, they're always willing to help. And what we do is with our NABAs is we're trying to build the capacity of our NABAs. And so we use the SBDC centers to help do that. And so we're, Luke and I attend a call, do you call it your meow?
We call it the meow. It's designed to be funny and light. Our CEO doesn't really like that name, so he's changed that name and still refer to it as meow. It's one of our initiatives, is to try to bring more people together, because we all support entrepreneurs in the ecosystem. One of our initiatives over the last 2 years has been to create, oh my gosh, I'm on.
There we go. Has been to create more interconnection, collaboration, and cooperation. And I think when Maria came on, there was a natural outreach, Great Falls person. I know Luke from before. We're connected with other NABAs. So trying to bring more people together to provide support where and fill in where you're strong, we're weak, and vice versa. And I don't think, I can't speak for everybody within the SBDC network statewide, but I can say, I never want to take the place of someone who's more culturally knowledgeable. I would prefer to fill in where there's a skill set that can be added, where we can then add value. So sorry, I don't know if I interrupted Maria, your train of thought there. And Ray, you had a question.
Yeah,
a
quick question.
Yeah, for you?
Yeah. Your peer-to-peer mentoring program, that you're is that gonna be replacing the SCORE? Retired executives, or is it a part of SCORE?
Very good question. So the SBA, I'll back up and give some context, right? The SBA funds, as I'm sure many of you are aware, access to capital programs, SBA 7A, SBA 504, PPP, all of the pandemic related stuff. The other real element of SBA is it funds resource partner programs. SBDC is the largest group. Women's Business Center, which I've been engaged with the University of Montana and the Montana Native Growth Funds in Hays, here in Great Falls as well, and the Veterans Business Outreach Center. So there's those three primary full-time professions. SCORE is a group of volunteers around the state and frankly around the country. The quality of those mentors substantially varies based on participation, because they're all volunteers. In Great Falls, in our region, and there's some active SCORE chapters. Billings has a good active SCORE chapter, Bozeman as well. The Great Falls area chapter was discontinued for cause for some kind of ugly reasons, and the district office has made that determination to not have an active chapter locally here, so that some of that negativity could go away. We proactively chose to not participate with the SCORE. They asked us to host a SCORE chapter. We decided to not do that, instead to create our own. What SCORE is versus what we're trying to put together, SCORE is one-on-one. It's legitimately retired executives, primarily mentoring people through the process. Well, we can do that with our professionals, our advisors, our coaches, counseling and advising and training. What our Perspectives program, our CEO roundtable program will be specifically targeting second stage companies, ready, capable, and wanting to grow. And they mentor each other. One of the obstacles that we all have is this perception problem. Well, you're not an entrepreneur, so how can you ever understand my problems? Well, I have been an entrepreneur, and I refer to myself as a recovering entrepreneur and a retired journalist for specific reasons. I don't have the risk assessment right now to be an entrepreneur. I just don't. But there is still this perception problem amongst second stage companies that are trying to grow, that have like 10, 11, 12, 50 employees, who need to get to 75 or 100 employees and are doing a million in revenue, but have the capacity or desire or market demand to get to 5 million or 50 million or 100 million in sales annually. I don't know all of the intricate details, but when there's somebody else within the room who's doing that today, the real-time, on-time learning opportunity, solving problems in a room, sharing experiences, that's what we're trying to cultivate with that CEO roundtable.
I do want to make another comment if you put yourself on mute, please.
Thank you for the reminder.
So I just wanted to call out, you know, we have a couple NABAs in the room. Ray is our NABA at Fort Belknap, and Brian is our NABA for Little Shell. And so what I wanted to just to call out to STED is the partnership between SBDC and our ICED NABAs. For example, this fiscal year, when we went through the Indian Equity Fund applications at Fort Belknap, we hooked Ray and his team up with Joe LaPlante at Bear Paw Development in Havre. And we work with our NABA on Blackfeet is Matt Harrington, and he's part of that NACDC, the native CDFI there. And so he works a lot with Rich Gannon. Rich is at a cut bank. And so it's just a great partnership is really what I want to emphasize. And then Mark Sansifer at Fort Peck, he's our NABA, and he works for Great Northern Development. And he is a tribal member up there. But so it's just a natural fit. You know, our NABAs are, we strive for our NABAs to be native CDFIs that no business, no can provide technical assistance, but we don't have that in all cases. And so we really rely on our SBDCs to help build the capacity, you know, eventually, like we were talking about earlier, Richard said that they'd like to have a NABA on the Chippewa Cree. Well, if that happens next year and they need some capacity building, we are gonna be relying on the SBDCs to help with that capacity building. So just wanted to add that.
So I wanna throw in a comment and a question here. So my first question is, who is our local affiliate at Flathead?
In Kalispell?
Is it Kalispell?
It's at Flathead Valley Community College.
Okay. Is mm-hmm. there one in Missoula?
Yes, at the University of Montana. They have currently three FTEs. There's one FTE in Kalispell. Here's the one of the, oops, I probably need to unmute here. One of the things that our strategic planning and accreditation process turned up this last year, we'll go through accreditation every 7 years with our national association. The accreditation team indicated to us that there needs to be less siloing, and some of the ecosystem work that I've tried to do over the last 2-3 years, really since the preparation for the 2019 legislative session, is to bring more people together and stop saying, well, it's a Great Falls advisor or it's a Kalispell-based advisor, so they can only work with somebody in Big Fork, in Kalispell, and so on. Dan is an example in Kalispell at Flathead Valley. He's an active banker. And so guess what he knows a lot about? Debt coverage ratios and so on. But he also has 25 years prior experience in banking. He's the only one in the network in the entire state of Montana who is an active lender. So when I have questions that I don't know the answers to, and I have some experience, but I haven't actually underwritten anything ever. So I ask him. Meanwhile, Jen, in our Missoula office, you mentioned Jen, she's a regional director there at UM within the Accelerate Montana team. She's a marketing professional. So I have a marketing question that I don't know the answer to, or some nuanced detail about TikTok. I probably call an MSU Extension agent, ironically, that I know. Or I talk to Jen. If I have an HR-related question, I talk to Jordan in the Zoo office because she came to us from Job Service. So what we're trying to do, I think, with our strategic planning as a network is kind of remove some of those barriers based on locale. and just know that we're all available. It's also worth noting that we also recognize that there are gender differences, that there are socioeconomic differences, and we want to be able to put an advisor in front of an entrepreneur who's best suited to engage with that entrepreneur on their level. Does that answer your question?
Yep, thank you.
Pontificate on my own verbosity is what my dad used to call it. Am I unmuted? I think I've covered all of these things here. We train a lot of people. We engage with a lot of people. That's the point. We're also generalists, inch deep and a mile wide. And some of us have an inch wide and a mile deep. And the next slide here, the Procurement Technical Assistance Center, is where we can get entrepreneurs. And you, in this room, I'm certain that you're all familiar with PTACs because there is a Native American PTAC that serves the community. The Montana PTAC also has some overlap in that area. GFDA has one FTE, two people serving basically the same coverage area as the Great Falls SBDC and the Golden Triangle. There is a PTAC that covers Glacier County that's in Kalispell. She's an MWED. Christy Cummings Dawson is in Kalispell. So for those who aren't aware, and these numbers have actually changed recently, our match has gone down to, I believe, 30 or 38%. Through DOD, the DLA funds part of the program, through Big Sky, which is the lead center, Big Sky Economic Development Billings, and then we invoice them for services rendered every quarter, I believe. There are 300 PTACs nationwide, including the Native American PTAC, seven in Montana under the Montana heading, with, I believe, currently 9 total advisors. Similar stuff to what NABAs do, similar stuff to what SBDCs do, but substantially more subject matter based expertise. One of the things, by the way, we had a meeting recently with Northrop Grumman as they're preparing to upgrade the missile silos. And so we're gonna be hosting and preparing some marketing materials in partnership with Northrop Grumman. I've already engaged with Christy Dawson at MWED in Kalispell about how do we make sure that Browning-based or Browning area businesses or others statewide that have certain set-aside status are aware in the system and get as much access and opportunity to that. That's a major league project. And we want to make sure that people know what the NAICS codes are that is going to be looked for within the totality of that project.
75 years.
That's been it. Yeah. I don't think I'll be around when that's over. Yes, sir.
Quick question about,
are you on mute?
No. Okay. Identifying opportunities through your organization, your PTAC organizations. Is there I know there's a sign up process that you do, but what are the costs associated with those?
To find opportunities or to be a PTAC client?
To be a PTAC client. Oh, really? Wow, okay.
The question was, and I was on mute, the question was, what is the cost associated with being a PTAC client? Same as the SBDC, it's federally funded, free to access. The only time that we ever charge for anything is if we're offering a training that has overhead. So the most recent example, and I don't know that PTAC has ever charged for something, but we do increasingly moving forward want to see a little skin in the game. What we've found statistically through the analysis of previous offerings is that people go through to the completion stage. We're not trying to put information in people's heads. We want to see action. We want to put people through a program so that in this potential example, their cybersecurity plan goes from zero to ready for government contract with DOD. So cyber is a huge thing across all programs right now, specifically within the Department of Defense. So the long story is, it's probably not going to cost anybody anything, especially to get a DUNS number, to get into SAM, for assistance getting into EMACS. Most likely is not going to cost anybody anything unless they're going to the wrong provider, because there are businesses out there that will charge for those services. And then the other thing is that we provide solicitation notices. They'll go to an email inbox of the business specific to their NAICS codes or preferred NAICS codes that, okay, that screens out the federal opportunities that are relevant.
Yeah, that's what the cost would have been. I was thinking, but so most of my businesses that I help out, they're interested in those bid solicitations, bid matching, I guess is what they're called. Right. And I'm sure NADC does that as well.
Yeah. I believe when you become a registered PTAC client and have worked through the formal application process, which is a formal request for assistance plus confidentiality acknowledgement, you can then, with your PTAC advisor, go into the bid match system because you're a PTAC client and say, these are the opportunities, these are the NAICS codes that I want sent to me. And there's always an opportunity to refine and update that.
Thank you.
But I know about this much, Ray, of so much more of that because we've got two specialists in the office. We also are host, and again, GFDA offers three basic types of services: access to loan capital, and fingers crossed, one of my initiatives over the last 2 years as well, access to equity capital, project and regional advocacy support for the region, for talent, business attraction, and so on. And then technical assistance, SBDC, I mentioned three technical assistance programs that were funded, SBDC, PTAC, and the Food and Ag Development Center, funded by the Montana Department of Agriculture. So food, ag, energy, and bioscience are the areas of subject matter expertise for our PTAC. Our most recent award specifically indicated that our goal with our PTAC program is out of market investment in value-added ag within the Golden Triangle. So most of our FADC activities, which is similar in some ways and different in other ways from the other FADC centers statewide, we do out of market outreach. So similar in what the Department of Commerce has recently added, you know, target market business attraction. So engaging in more value added within the Golden Triangle. There's a lot of overlap with SBDC and FADC. We do a lot of GTA applications. We do a lot of IEF applications. One of the things, Maria, that we did during this most recent IEF round is we utilized one of our tools, the Live Plan, which is a cloud-based business planning tool. And Luke engaged us on this. We actually created a form, the standard template. And then whomever wanted to use it could just use it, with the goal of making your job analyzing those applications faster and easier. And really what we found was a lot of the people who were coming to us for some help, and Matt Harrington made a lot of those referrals, needed to get their IEF application done quickly, within 24, 48 hours, as I'm sure you guys are all aware. Some folks come to the party a little late. And really having that framework already done. Here's the template. Can you get it done in 24, 48 hours? And some people did. I haven't followed up recently on where the awards were and whether or not there was a percentage of success higher than others. I don't know.
What was that called again?
The cloud-based business planning software that we offer to anyone who wants to use it is called LivePlan, LivePlan. And we offer that as a free tool as well. And this is where, again, we've more than willing to offer an opportunity or a tool or a resource to fill in where someone else doesn't have that resource.
And the question.
Sean, are you on? Because you're in the ag department of Little Bighorn College. Is this a resource that you guys can use? And if so, Jason, can you go out of your 13 area region?
Unmute. We can. we only pay for 10 licenses because we're trying to be fiscally responsible. So we would refer to whomever is closest to Bighorn College who has licenses. And not all centers statewide, SBDCs have Life Plan. Some CRDCs have them. I know Sweetgrass here. Yes. Sorry, I misunderstood your question. We could. We prefer for them to potentially work with somebody in their area if possible. However, if there's a personality conflict, if there's a timing conflict, whatever those things may be, we cannot say no to service. If somebody knocks on the door, we answer the door.
Can you send me the contact for the food service crowd?
I can. Okay, for food and ag?
For food and ag, yeah.
Can you remind me? Somebody write that down.
Yep.
I will forget. As Lillian in our PTAC office says, my brain isn't the steel trap it used to be. So somebody will ask me a question and I may forget. So I think we've covered what FADC is. This kind of covers a little bit all of it, but obviously FADC and SBDC differ based on subject matter expertise and target industries. What else? We are not a host organization, but we house. Thank you. We house MMEC, Manufacturing Extension Partnership in the state. We've got a guy who lives in Belt who uses our office on occasion. He's never in the office, so we've stolen back his office. The other research SBA resource partner programs, Veterans Business Outreach Center, based Region 8, VBOC is based out of Billings, serves three states. So they often rely on making referrals to boots on the ground, as it were. I partner with VBOC on teaching the introduction to entrepreneurship classes at Malmstrom Air Force Base called Boots to Business, curriculum generated by Syracuse University. We deliver that quarterly. And then the Women's Business Center programs, there is a new center in Montana housed at the university called the Women's Entrepreneurship and Leadership Lab, the WELL, WBC. There's also a WBC program at Prospera in Bozeman. They cover the two counties that Prospera covers, also an SBDC host. The new centers it is a decentralized model. I worked actually on the RFP response last year, and we were awarded. So Great Falls will be we will house a UM employee, technically a Montech employee, within the WBC flag serving the Great Falls region. There will also be somebody housed by Montana Native Growth Fund and HAZE serving that region and that community as well. So those are some of the other things that we do in terms of technical assistance, but we don't actually provide financial support for that. Well, with that being said, we will be providing some financial support for the Women's Business Center. So why? I always like to get to the why elements of any and all of this. Really, the GFDA mission is to grow and diversify the regional economy by supporting the creation of higher wage jobs. And I'm sure that that's something that you all can identify with. We would like to see more, more personal income growth, more household income growth, more self-sustained income for people in their homes. And sometimes that means a manufacturing facility started in the kitchen or in the garage by makers and artists. Really our value here is to provide leadership and to bring people together, provide resources to make things happen that may otherwise not. So I've spent a lot of my time at GFDA building inclusive teams so that we can have comprehensive impacts. And then some statistics there about our region. Some success stories here, not necessarily relevant. Childcare is a big deal. I'm currently serving on a task force with Family Connections, which is funded by DPHHS, trying to come up with very creative action-oriented solutions in the childcare space. This project referenced here utilized brownfield funds, an SBA 504 loan, and then 4 years of planning with SBDC. This is a Geraldine-based company. They use three of our four technical assistance programs, SBDC, FADC, and PTAC, and adjacently affiliated to MMEC as well. They designed the Pardew Grain facility in Glacier County that's recently gone through an ownership change. And then we do success stories. One of our success stories this year is Barbara Paul there. She's got property on both sides of the Rocky Mountain fronts in Glacier County and Flathead County. One of our other success stories this year was a home-based manufacturer, Montana Mutt. Kind of a side hustle job. She makes projects. She makes organic dog treats, and she does it at her kitchen table. So we like to highlight those types of businesses because it inspires people to say, I can do that at home too. And maybe someday it will become my full-time job because guess what? I don't want to work for anyone anymore. I hear that a lot from veterans. So that's the essence of it. And I don't know if I went over my 20 or 30 minutes. Hopefully I've addressed SBDC, how we all interact, how we could interact, how we can support. Yes, and that's actually a distant relation. Oh. Yeah, Richard mentioned Ray Nitschke, who's a Hall of Famer with the Green Bay Packers. He died before I got a chance to meet him, but I tell you, if you see my grandfather and him, there's clearly a family relation. My sister, who played softball at the University of North Dakota during her undergraduate degree, she wrote a paper on this and did basically the family tree, which traced back. Cool. Most people don't care, but thank you. I'm glad somebody recognized. And we have a Rich Gannon on staff who was a quarterback with Kansas City.
Yeah. Oh, I think we said 1240.
Oh,
hi, do we have, can you give me a nod or something if you're back on, Sean and Cheryl and Luke? Are you guys with us? Oh, well, maybe they're not there. Sean, are you with us? Cheryl? Sean's here. Okay, thank you. Cheryl? Luke is here. We got the thumbs up. Thank you. Cheryl, are you with us? Yeah, and then Richard too. Cheryl, are you with us? Sean, did you get something good to eat? All right, we're getting started here in the room. So we have up on the screen the next part of the section. Who is it?
Gerald.
All right, they just did a drawing here in the room, and it looks like Gerald Gray's the winner. Woo! All right, so I'm going to hand the mic back over to Chairwoman Fiant. I'm going to go on mute.
Okay, this is the moment that we've all been waiting for since our strategic planning process. And this is where we all get to report out as commissioners on the focus areas that we've been working so hard on these last couple months. So we'll start off with focus area one, which is funding, and I'll turn it over to Ray King.
Thank you, Shelley. I've been working with Billy on developing an inventory, an application process, how we're going to evaluate those items, and then developing a list of grant writers to share with tribal economic development directors. So in our original strategic planning session, we all generated a list of federal and state, local foundation opportunities to target grants. So we came up with a list. Billy's been awesome in generating that list, and where we've been bouncing back and forth trying to figure out how this is going to be impactful for the commission and the planners throughout the state, tribal planners. And we're liking how, you know, this whole thing fit together with developing relationships with the other economic development organizations throughout the state. So we're gonna continue developing the list and identifying links, and then setting up how we're gonna do this whole identification of the grants. Are we going to put it up on a PDF? We're going to put it up on a website. We want to make it available to the people on the STED Commission, and then the tribal planners, the grant writers.
No, I just wanted to add that one of the ideas was to use a gov delivery system that the state of Montana uses to push out all of their information to their constituents. And I talked to Dan about it briefly. I haven't been able to connect with the right IT folk, but we did talk about doing a similar email blast to the commission members with some of this information on state grants, federal grants, to share with everybody on a bi-weekly basis.
Thank you, Billy. So, you know, with all these bi-weekly meetings, we're hoping to I see that in the nicest way. we could kind of see how this is all going to come together as long as we stay connected with each other through these bi-weekly meetings. That's nice. I said that nice. So we're going to, our action items and goal B, economic development opportunity forum. We're going to share information with tribal planners at the regularly scheduled calls. So as this system progresses, we'll give updates as to how that system is going to be implemented and what system we're going to be utilizing.
Can I add to that?
Mm-hmm.
Are we on mute? Is everybody muted? Okay, when he says regular, we're going to share information with tribal planners on regularly scheduled calls. So one of the things that we started at the Office of Indian Country is we do monthly phone calls with the tribal planners across the state. And we talk about a lot of different things and have guest speakers. So that's where we would want our tribal planners. And I'm looking at Tracy specifically because we'd really like to have you on those calls. And you should be on the invite list to them. It's just a forum. One of the things when I started in this role is I'm all about collaboration and not reinventing the wheel. And what I've noticed is our tribal planners and our economic development folks, you know, they're kind of in their own world, and they're not really, they don't really know what all the other tribes are doing. And so the goal of this monthly tribal planners call is to collaborate, to help them get ideas, share information, not reinvent the wheel if possible, and then for us as a state organization to help support their efforts. So that's what that means on that goal, action item number one. Thank you, Ray.
Yes, thank you, Maria. So yeah, as we move through these forums and have discussion, we're hoping to get some more input as to how this can be more effective for each tribe or each individual tribe. And that's all I have. Do you guys have anything else to add, Billy?
I do.
Thank you, Ray. Did you have a question, Richard?
I was just wondering. Teleconference is penetration is. I'm in the get to be in there once in a while or not have a meeting. They hold those on a quarterly basis.
Not currently, I don't do that. Our poor BillNet planning director would probably be the one to do that. I'm with a community development financial institution, but we can identify somebody in our planning department to target that group and hopefully get an invite.
I don't see an app for that.
Sorry. So the question Richard had was, is Ray and Fort Belknap in on the Region 8 EDA planning call quarterly basis? So, and he said, no, not currently, because he's with the CDFI, but maybe as planning staff will be in the future. Okay, does anybody have something? Go ahead, Maria.
So what I wanted to add is just as a reminder, for some of you that are online and in the room, this Focus Area 1 funding for the tribe's economic development, if you recall, we looked at the statute, why the State Tribal Economic Development Commission was formed in the first place. And this is one of the reasons, is to help find funding for tribal economic development. So that's what this Focus Area 1, you know, we're starting with in your packet. You have state grants and you have federal grants, but what we're trying to do is make this online and kind of, if you're involved in MEDA, you know how MEDA sends out the Montana Economic Developers Association, they send out information across the state to the economic development groups. We want to kind of do that in Indian Country, where we are sending out information on a regular basis on funding that's available for the tribes. So that's where we're trying to get to. And we're just taking these, you know, we just came up with this strategy. So this is the first steps to get there. So I just wanted to clarify that because some folks are here that really weren't in our planning. Thank you.
Okay. Are there any other questions for Ray before we move on? Well, thanks for that report, Ray. You must have been doing double duty because you were in on Focus Area 3 too.
Right, yeah. So,
thank you. Okay, we'll move on to Focus Area 2, which was assessment. Cheryl?
Hi. Okay, so I worked with Maria and Billy on this, and thank you for your help and the guidance on this. What we went through was goal assessment A, or goal A assessment. Number one, review current assessment, review the current assessment process begin being conducted by the University of Montana. So the notes that were taken from this meeting was that the STED staff will provide a template to the commissioners to present to their tribal council to support a tribal resolution to assist BBER in their data collection. Number two, Billy will reach out to Pad McCracken and find out the next steps. Number 2A, years need to be defined by the State Tribal Relations Interim Committee, and 2B is identify funding resources. Item two, additional assessment needs, create a strategy for strengthening the current assessment and or future assessments. And the notes from that was to be discussed at the 2021 November STEDS meeting, which is today, and analyze the things we went through was to analyze the housing needs and how many jobs will be created, the ARPA economic impact, and then the American Community Survey employment status, TANF households demographics. Those were just some places that was identified to collect data. Number three, says review.
Cheryl, can we back up to number one for a second? Because I had you on mute. I was trying to get you unmuted. So folks kind of missed that number one. And this is going to be important for-
Good afternoon, do we have all council?
Sorry,
STED, this is that assessment and, you know, from BBER. So those STED commission members, do you remember this discussion at all where we had BBER come in and tell us their progress, that they were trying to get all of the data for the tribes to do that report? Okay, so that's what this is. And what has happened in recent months is there's a legislative committee called the State Tribal Relations Committee. You guys know that because we were here in Great Falls and they had the meeting at the Little Shell office. But for the rest of the STED committee members, we presented to the State Tribal Relations Committee about this assessment. And basically, we told them, myself and Misty Cool, number one, in the statute, it's not clear, in this House bill, it's not clear because it says starting in 2020, that there will be a decennial report. Well, does that mean that the report comes out in 2030? So that's one of the questions. And then the second question is, there was only $48,000 allocated to do this work back in 2019. And in 2020 with COVID, you know, it was basically nothing happened. So that's the second thing. And so the State Tribal Relations Committee and this Pad McCracken.
Can I add something?
Yes.
In addition, in order to fulfill the requirements of the report, the budget would have to be somewhere between the amount of data that is by design to be collected between $200,000 and $250,000. So it's only a couple hundred grand short. So it's, you know, $48,000 is a lot of money, but it isn't a lot of money when you have this long laundry list and the amount of work that is expected to be included in the report. So,
yeah, and Scott was on mute, but he was saying that we're about, you know, $200,000 short of what we need to do a proper assessment. And keep in mind, this is a statewide economic impact, a tribal economic impact assessment. So what do the tribes contribute to the overall economy in the state of Montana? And that's the challenge we're facing with this. We are responsible, STED, Commerce, you know, we're responsible for getting this assessment out there. So the plan is to have, and the next legislative session, have amendment to the bill to be more specific about, okay, when does it start? When does it end? What years is it going to cover? And where are we going to get the money to fund it? So that's, Cheryl, I just wanted to add that because that this is, you know, all of you have seen the Yellow Robe report that came out before, and everybody's always asking about it. Where is it? When are we going to update it? But this is the, I guess, behind the scenes of what's going on. As STED members, you know, it will be important for you to understand this in case you get any questions. Thank you, Cheryl.
Sure, thank you. Okay, and then the last one, number three, that I was just going to review was on the SES review, and it says review and determine common themes of the tribes, and that was notes. STEDS and OICED are partnering with NADC on an EDA grant to do a phase one comprehensive analysis of the SEDS for tribes. Phase two is identifying funding resources. And that was discussed this morning, right?
Right.
So yeah, the clarification you gave, Maria, for number one is great, because that was one of the questions I was going to actually ask was, when you were mentioning years, like how far do we go back? Does it just start from when the Yellow Rope report ended, you know, to current? So those things need to be determined. But I was wondering in the report if it was going to encompass, of course, the revenue that's brought in by tribes, you know, through oil and gas leases, when we recruit other oil and gas companies, say from Colorado or wherever, to be here. They also pay state, you know, taxes and state fees in addition to tribal fees. So that is money we're bringing in. But do you think this also includes travel that the tribe does? I think I might have had this conversation yesterday where the Blackfeet tribe, for example, we spend a lot of money in Kalispell, Montana, for when we go to fairs, we set up conferences, we put a lot of money in their economy. Same for Great Falls. Just as, you know, the state offices or any other governmental office is putting money in different areas within the state to host different meetings. Is that valid to put those types of things in there? Or is it mainly just the revenue that's brought in and the jobs that are created?
I'm not sure how that would be captured, you know, for every single...
It might be just getting into the weeds of things, because that's captured through our, you know, finance. And our accounting data that we have, because we have line item budgeting, and so it shows how much we've traveled. You know, if you were just to grab a travel line item or grab a training line item, you know, for specific dates that we were in, say, Great Falls or Kalispell. But that might be getting into the weeds of stuff.
Well, and then you have a point, Cheryl, if everybody can look at goal A, you might have to change your screen, goal A, number one. And the note one, it says the STED staff will provide a template to the commissioners to present to their tribal council to support a tribal resolution to assist BBR in their data collection. And so, Billy, you want to talk about that for a minute?
Yes.
That's something we talked at the last STED meeting.
Okay. So in your packets on the right side, the very last page, is a draft template that I drafted to take before your tribal council to get their buy-in for the data collection for BBER to work directly with the tribes. Now, this was really, I've never written a resolution before, so but I did give it a good guess. And
we just took the tribal resolution and, you know, used a template. You guys all have your own tribal resolutions that you can use, but this was just some words that you can use out of it. But I think the real discussion here is the timing of this. You know, do we do it now and have BBER continue trying to gather the data so that we're prepared at the next legislative session, or do we wait for the next legislative session and have asked for that amendment of the House bill?
What kind of response did you get from that? The legislative committee.
So the question is, what kind of response did we get with from the State Tribal Relations Committee when we met? They seemed, you know, they listened to what kind of I just told you here. They listened. They seemed to be open to taking it forward. That Pat McCracken, who's the their liaison. We asked them to put that on the agenda for the next meetings, you know, so we can keep this in front of them. There were questions. Representative, what's her name from Great Falls here? Representative Galloway, Sheldon Galloway. She didn't really understand why we needed the assessment. She had some questions of like, can't we just demand that the tribes give us this data, you know, that kind of thing. She was more questioning for understanding than, you know, just didn't understand.
She didn't understand anything.
Yeah.
My suggestion would be that we anticipate what some of the objections and or the concerns might be in terms of sharing the data, because obviously there's a certain amount of proprietary information on a tribe by tribe basis that you know, should remain that way, because you know, just based upon tribal governance, you can decide how you use your money and what you do with it on one hand. On the other hand, I think what's really important is trying to understand the economic value to the state as a whole of the tribes and what they contribute to the state, what you contribute to the state. And also then to be able to put in perspective then what we should be doing at the state and aligning with all of the other federal programs and everything else like that to optimize every dollar. And it's not about how much money is there. It's how are we using the money and how are we impacting the communities that we're trying to serve. 10% or more of our population in the state is an indigenous population. We need to think about that, at least from my perspective, in commerce and how we then use our resources, because we're trying to serve 100% of the state. So, and I'm not saying that it has to be a purely numbers type of thing, but we have to recognize the significance of it. But without data and without some kind of cooperative sharing of information, maybe we could do this with a lot, you know, with a lot less of an effort if we actually would all sit down and could say, hey, we've got a closed door, if you will, of sharing of information to be able to find out what are all of the economics within each one of the tribal entities, and then amalgamate it so that it has some obfuscation, if you will, appropriately, and then bring that back out. Maybe there's an interim step that doesn't take $200,000 to get there, but we've got to take a step forward, at least in my opinion. Otherwise, we're just going to keep circling around this whole thing of, well, where's the money coming from? What are we going to do? What makes sense to take the first step forward? Because for us to help, I mean, I'm taking myself out of stead right now, but for putting myself in the commerce position, for us to do with the Office of Indian Country Economic Development what we should be doing, we need enough data. Otherwise, we're just putting Band-Aids on or propping up little types of things which are successful. And I have no problem with those individual successes, but are we attacking the bigger problems that will make step function changes that need to be made in tribal entities? So that, I mean, that's a lot of stuff to just sort of throw out on the table, but you know, the question is there enough willingness to cooperate for us to maybe get enough information to have a meaningful representation and presentation that could be then given to the legislators in advance? And we start, you have to start selling. I mean, I'm learning this process pretty fast. I haven't been in government a long time, but I understand selling, and we have got to start promoting information that we do have and the focus that we need in order for us to do economic development in Indian country the way that we should and we could, rather than just these little tranches of activity. So the big picture is really huge, but nobody really understands that. I mean, how many billion dollars do the tribes collectively create and generate within the GDP of the Montana economy? No one has an idea right now. The mindset, however, is that Indian country costs us money. Well, you either have to prove or disprove that, but it's also a sort of a thing that we have to be able to represent that value and establish it with some facts. And then I think when you know that value, and that value is as large as I believe it is, then we can do more. And getting this money to finish this study, I think, will be child's play by comparison to understanding what the bigger picture is. That's just my two cents worth on trying to solve this problem from a bigger picture standpoint.
Thank you for that.
Yep.
Richard?
There's so much happened. There's so much that happened since then. There's more money coming into the tribes through the CARES dollars, the Recovery Act, as well as there's going to be more money coming down to the
all these other things.
Build America Better.
Yeah.
Build a Better America. And those are not factored in yet. But having gone through the first phase, second phase of it, it is actually a report of the economic contributions that we gave to the bordering towns within our area. It's kind of brought back to the welcome address by the mayor here, where he suggested, where he thanked us for being here, but he also thanked us for the money that we're going to spend here in Great Falls. So those are the factors that we had in mind, was how much do we contribute to Hill County, Great Falls, you know, those towns border reservations. I know the we have a lot of legislators that don't have a reservation within miles and miles of their community, and they really don't understand the economic impact that tribes do have on those communities they reside in. Right. And I think the whole study was focused on not only the border towns, but through the whole state. Show that tribes contribute to the economic structure of the state of Montana,
okay,
how much we contribute.
And do we have that? Has that been shared?
I'll actually, if you'll go through, I don't know how many still have that report, but that'll show how much money the Rocky Boy Reservation had, with how much actually went into Havre, Great Falls, and how it turned over maybe seven times before it left communities. That's an economic factor that we always use, that so at least turns over seven times before it leaves the community. So it generates a lot of money for those towns that border the reservations.
When was that report done?
That's a Yellow Road report.
That's the Yellow Road.
Okay. Yeah, right. It was done two phases.
Actually, no, I think the last one was done by Congress in 2015 and the Yellow Road report.
Yeah.
Like, I don't know, Dan, you can pull it up on our website.
Six, maybe?
Six?
It's been quite a while.
It's been
a lot of new dynamics going on.
Yeah.
Even since 2014 or 13.
So, I guess the question on the table is, you know, what Director Osterman said is there something we can start, like pulling the tribes together and collecting the data? I mean, you know, BBR has been contracted to do this, and we extended their contract, and it's coming up, I think, at the end of the year. So we'll have to do something, probably amend it, extend it again. Of next year, June 30th next year. And so, I mean, we're looking for feedback here because BBR is basically, you know, we've sent letters to the tribes from STED Commission. We've educated STED, we've educated Tribal Relations Committee, we've talked to the Indian Caucus, but we know that the tribe's been so busy with COVID and all these other things, now ARPA, you know, the COVID dollars, and we just can't get anybody's attention on how to get this data. So we're really looking for ideas, and without the data, we can't do anything, so.
Richard had something.
Okay, let me get off.
I think I've been kind of waiting for this resolution to be presented to the business committee, but there are probably a few things that maybe we should add, I would think. You know, to do a good study, you're going to need the numbers. I know the number that was presented to the legislature was cut significantly, but in order for us to get a good report, we should have the numbers in here, how much we need.
Like, what do you mean? Well,
let's say we got 45,000, but we actually need 140,000 to get a good report.
Mm-hmm. Put that in the resolution?
Yeah. If it's coming from the tribes, it wouldn't necessarily come to, it's coming from the tribes, not coming from STED. The tribes can use that as the figures to the legislature.
So I think the resolution was for each tribe to be able to give the data to the consultant hired by STED. President Gray?
Yeah, so.
Good point. Yeah, I think we are. That's very important data to be accurate about, because we need, you know, there's just so many moving parts. Like I think about ARPA funds, you know, CSKT got like $89 million just with ARPA funding. We're not even talking about all the money that's available out there through the infrastructure bill now. That's not to even mention the money that CSKT has received the last 2 years for our water compact. And that will affect the whole state. It's not just our reservation. Right. You know, that money is going to flow out. That's going to turn over that 7 times at least. So, you know, what is our starting point? What is our parameters, you know, that we need all that data? So.
And the question is what are you willing to? Which is what this study is designed to try to represent.
What kind of data is being a significant amount and can all tribes provide it in a relatively simple fashion? And I wonder if that's some of the resistance. Is it data that needs to be accumulated? I would have to say probably in our case, there's some stuff we probably aren't accumulating data wise. Right.
Yeah.
So is that a problem for resistance to providing this data?
So there's a what is it called, Cheryl? It's a where all of the tribes have to report their federal revenue in.
Are you talking about the clearinghouse, the annual audit clearinghouse?
Yeah, the annual audit clearinghouse. So University of Montana. The business bureau that's been contracted to do this work, they went out there and got and received that data. They have that data.
Oh.
The problem is all of the tribes aren't up to date on what they've put in there.
It's 2 years old, 4 years old, etc. So it's not the representation. We're still with that line there. Because of the change, it's going to be through the decennial report. And if we say it's 2020, we're still going to be back in 2016, 17, 18 in some numbers. So it's not going to reflect CARES Act. It's not going to reflect some of these other things. Because we also have to be analyzed to be able to say, hey, this is a blip, right? What you don't want to do is have a slice in time and say, wow, look at all that. This and expect that that's going to continue on an annual basis either, because we all know this is a one-time deal, right? Let's hope for it anyway. Otherwise, our great-grandchildren's grandchildren will be paying for it, right? So I think that's what we also have to actually represent, is that once that tails off, and the impact tails off in the next 2, 3, or 4 years, where are we going to be, and what does that need to look like, and how do we help develop economically so that that drop off isn't a cliff? It's, you know, it's maybe a dip, but there's a development process set out there that's can start to bring it back up. It's essentially from growing as opposed to
Yeah, by federal law, we have to do an audit every year. So that it's just a 1 year backlog, as you would see. But probably one of the problems that we have on our reservation is getting our enterprises to get their audits to us also. So actually, the tribe gets dinged.
Yeah, you hurt yourself.
Yeah, we hurt ourselves by the enterprises not giving us the information, their audits that we can compile into one book to send to as our audit for let's say FY 21. So until that time, we're going to be held as our audit's not going to be acceptable by a lot of agencies. So it's something that we're working on now, and maybe that's probably one of the problems that they may be running into is enterprises reporting directly to the tribal business committee, what their profits and non-profit, their, whether they made a profit at all. So we're working on getting our audits. And so.
Not all the data.
Not all. Mm-hmm. So, so they have that data that is federally available, but they don't have the rest of the economic data to fill out the rest of the whole big picture. You know, they have that slice, so it's older, but it's probably only about 20%.
Mm-hmm. Like they don't have the tribal college data. They don't have Indian Health Service. They don't have the human services. You know, they're it was just whatever the tribes report on their audits. So it's just a portion. And I'm going to be the angel's advocate here. And I know this was a bill. I know that this was came forward from the legislators in 2019. But if we're struggling to get and to get the data, how important is this for the tribes? You know, this is coming from the legislators, but really how important is it from the tribes? Do the tribes really, do you really care? Do you need it? Do you use it? You know, this is coming from the legislators, but how important is this? That's my question.
So I'll give you my perspective from CSKT in that we have the border town situations. You know, we have a lot of leakage off of our reservation. Most of our money goes out to Missoula County and Flathead County for big ticket items and even small ticket items. So to, I guess, illustrate that, and also with our local county commissioners, you know, we have a very adversarial relationship now. In fact, Misty Cool is meeting with Lake County today. Commissioners today, yes. 3:00, over an issue. I don't even want to talk about that. But to educate them on really the economic impacts, because the tribe is the largest employer in Lake County. But we're just not appreciated for our economic contributions. So it's really important to us, but we did our own Beaver study. So, you know, we have that to give to the commissioners or whoever we want to distribute it to in an educational process. So that's just one perspective, and I'd be interested to hear everybody else's. So go ahead, Gerald.
With that, but we're also right down there. Make a big deal. Show that to this that we are, you know, a big contributor in the state of Montana. Some people don't think we are.
It is.
You know, going back to your point, do you think, you know, because of the turnover of tribal council, I think it's got to be brought fresh to the table to each of those councils to say, hey, this is where we need this, and this is why. I don't think a lot of them know. to be honest with you.
Do you think that...
I haven't brought this to my council.
Point.
So I think another issue is what I hear a lot of times in the legislature is that Indians don't pay taxes. We don't contribute to our individual counties that way. So where are they going to get the money, you know, based on just our land statuses, et cetera. So I think that's another issue that folds into this mix as well. So I think it's, especially on my reservation, it's really important to educate them, but also places where there are border towns where, you know, that's where all your money's going to, not all of it, but a lot of it. And we even have some studies that show that. We were part of a Northwest Area Foundation project with Fort Belknap, us, I think there was another tribe maybe, and we did this leakage analysis and just showed by industry where our money was going. It wasn't staying on the reservation for the most part, so it's important for that. But now a lot of our money is staying on the reservation with the CARES Act, ARPA funds, and in our case, the Water Compact. Go ahead.
Can we hear from Cheryl on Blackfeet? The question, Cheryl, is, I mean, do you really think that this report is needed? And any ideas on how to get the data? And then I'm going to add a third question. Would the tribes be willing to help? If it's that important to the tribes, would they be willing to help put some dollars into it?
Okay, some of you are kind of in and out, so I'm not hearing all the conversations. I did hear a lot of Shelley's, and thank you for sharing. In fact, I think it's great you guys did your own BBER. That's something we should be doing. We don't, you know, we have the data as we need it, and we can do our own internally by department, you know, grabbing the what we call our financial statements, our operating budgets by year, you know, and do an assessment or an analysis as we need them for certain grant proposals or different, you know, things like that. But I do believe it is important to, if I don't even know how to say it, I guess just justify that we are contributing to the state of Montana. We've had these conversations in at different venues. For example, we had these conversations with the oil and gas tax agreements, and I always bring this up when I have an opportunity to, because it appears that the information that the state requires is not always beneficial to the tribes, meaning that, you know, with the oil and gas tax agreements, we were asking that the formula be changed. And because we contribute to the state of Montana, we bring in these companies from Colorado, these oil and gas companies. And so the state, and they have to pay twice. They pay the tribes fees and then they pay the state's fees. So the state does get money but they don't put out any money, any expenditures for getting those companies here. It all falls on the tribes. So we have to send out our delegates to go meet with these oil and gas companies. We have to just put in all the time and all the effort. So at the expenses to the tribe, but then once the contracts are in place and the oil companies come into town on the reservation, they got to pay the state of Montana, but the state of Montana has never put a dime up to get them here. So that was one of the scenarios we used was, you know, why won't you change the formula to let us, and we have a choice, we don't have to be in a state tax agreement, you know, we could collect our own revenues. It's just easier because they've already got a system in place to do it. So we just share the revenues. But my point is that in that sharing, It's a very one-sided formula. They don't allow the tribes to use non-members or non-Indians in the formula to benefit the tribes to receive more revenue from the collections. We could never understand that because we put up the money to get those companies here to begin with, not them. And so that was kind of the idea, is that, you know, we're bringing money into, that was the first argument we've ever had a few years ago with the state when a delegation came out here. And it wasn't that we were trying to be argumentative, it's just that that's how it turned out, because they weren't understanding what we had done because they hadn't seen the numbers, if you will, of how much money we spent on getting this company to the Blackfeet Reservation in Montana. And so that's one scenario. So that was what, and we never won the argument. It never did come up on a STED's agenda, because I've asked that it be on a STED's agenda and that this formula be revisited. That hasn't happened to date. And then the other thing is that we needed this money, as Shelley and you, Maria, and Mr. Osterman pointed out, people think that we are not putting anything up. So we almost have to justify ourselves, you know, in the state of Montana, that yes, we are bringing money to the table. And they say that we don't pay taxes, but actually our Indian people do pay state property taxes when they do live on fee land on reservations, because a lot of people in Browning, there is fee land where they purchase houses and they have to pay property taxes to the county, and which is, you know, a state affiliation. So people are paying. And then if you're a non-member or non-Indian on working for the school system on your reservation, we'll say the Blackfeet Reservation, I know I'm getting that confused, they have to pay taxes. So taxes are coming from reservations. It may not be that Indian, like say a Blackfeet Indian myself living on my reservation, you know, making an income on my reservation, I'm tax exempt from state taxes, but I pay other things, you know. So I guess what I'm trying to say is that I believe there's a need to, in terms of having to justify ourselves only to the state of Montana, that we do, you know, bring money to the table. But in general, we collect our own data as needed to fill out our own reports and our own grants and our own, you know, type of financial sustainability. So that's, I can go both ways, but if it's a life or death situation, or if it's something that we need, you know, we absolutely need, no, it isn't. It's only to prove a point that we're contributing money. We already know that. That's all I have to say.
Yeah, and my third question to all of you is, would the tribes be willing to kick in some dollars to do this so we can get BBER contracted? Because really what BBER wants to do is they want to put out an RFP and hire somebody like Eleanor to go, you know, beat the bushes like she did before and go sit on the doorsteps of the tribes to get all of this data. I mean, this data, it took her like 2 years or 3 years to gather all of this data and put this report together. So right now, you know, we have $48,000 and BBER has already done some work. Like I said, they went to that clearinghouse and got all of the federal data that was there, that was available. So
what do you guys think?
Now, this is Ray. I believe this must be an easy sell to our tribal council. This information is going to be so valuable. All of our planning departments are so hard to do for us. Why not take that information and make it work for you for the longer term? I think it would be an easy sell to them.
Do you think your tribe would put up dollars?
Yeah, I definitely think they would.
Absolutely. I think also everyone would want the insurance that that's the best deal to be gotten. Mm-hmm. 250 sounds pretty steep to me, but I don't know.
You know, it's a 10-year report.
Yeah.
So yeah. It's something that should have old information,
yeah,
current information, and some forecasting.
Yeah.
As well, detail and then work through that to the next assembly report. So justifying that.
No, yeah.
We always have to figure out if it's the best price for that. I agree with that
100%. I don't have a frame of reference, but it's just that number kind of like somewhat.
Mm-hmm. Yeah. So, Gerald, did you say something?
Depend how much I think it would be definitely worth it.
Yeah. So maybe we should be asking BBR what they could do it for, how much they could do it for.
There's a good reason to go back to say, okay, we're going to spend $100,000 on this thing, but you have the gap if you understand the report to me, what you need, what would it take to at least get sort of a level one done. And here's the Volkswagen model of report.
Right.
And what's in between, and to be able to really say what is it, it's probably more about it. And Ed will have that conversation.
Well, and Cheryl is the head of this Focus Area 2 assessment. So I think Cheryl should be involved in that conversation. I don't know if you could hear.
I apologize. I couldn't understand or hear what was being said.
Director Osterman was saying that we should go back to BBR and say, okay, with the data that you already have, what need and what would it take, like a dollar amount, to get the information, you know, to do a full report.
Okay. Yeah, that's an option. Another option, I don't know if it's viable or not, but what about actually just creating another position like we did with the tourism, you know, where Daniel Iverson's position was created out of, I guess, carved out of the tourism dollars. If it's going to take 3 years to get this done, it may require, you know, a person on full time to actually do this and have a report, have some timelines, you know. So does that make sense? I don't know. That's just another option.
I don't know. I would rather see a professional, you know, like the University of Montana, BBER, do this, that this is what they do all the time. You know, they're an economic research group. And then you don't have all of the expense of an employee. Just contract with them and get it done. Contract with them, get it done, you know.
Okay. It's,
so I think in time constraint here, we need to put this on the next agenda for Cheryl, for this focus area two, and really talk about how are we gonna move this forward? Because I really don't want us to wait until the next legislative session, because we're going to get dinged. I mean, this is going to look like, you know, we haven't been doing anything. And I think that it sounds like, from what I'm hearing from those of you in the room, that you do want this report, that you do think it has some benefit, that you do feel like you need to justify, you know, the impact. So then let's figure out how to get it done.
Well, I'm sure when you go to legislators with this kind of data, it makes all of our programs much easier to justify, right? So then we, like, let's say the ICE grants, maybe that gets increased to, you know.
Wouldn't that be awesome? But they,
just throw numbers out, but I think we're kind of staying at the same, which is still great, but it's not, should it grow with what the data says?
Yeah, no, you have a good point. Right, right. Exactly. All right, Cheryl, did you finish your section?
Yes, I did. Thanks.
Thank you. All right, Chairwoman, I think we're ready to move on.
Okay. I have a schedule.
Hello? Hello?
Cheryl, I can hear you. Can you hear me?
I can, yeah. But I just can't hear them.
I can hear them, yeah.
Looks like she might be working on it, though. It says she's her iPad is connected to the audio.
So. Kind of long enough for there. Yeah, they can't hear us, look like.
Huh.
Quick note, you did a good job right there.
Oh, thank you. I know it sounds confusing. I always talk about, talk so fast and throw everything together, but we've been through this and I don't have an answer for how we could get, you know, the information.
I wonder if
every tribe. Mm-hmm.
I wonder if we should break up that assessment a little bit and then define it, all the different things that we need from it so that we have a clarification.
Oh, of each and good every idea. Yeah, no, that's a great idea. And maybe it wouldn't be so difficult for people to sit down and actually, you know,
right.
Give some time to go over it with us.
So one would be, you know, federal funding, one would be state funding, one would be foundation monies, general monies, indirect money. You just keep on going and you define it. And as you get the total impact, then you would check that box off.
No, I think that's great. And I think, you know, they brought up the same similar things that I was trying to say, but they said it better, that about, you know, how we spend money in these border towns and these other, like even these conferences, you know, bringing them to Great Falls and Billings and different places. We're bringing a lot of money to spending a lot of money in these areas around Montana.
So though we would have to define enrolled membership and descendancy and who is paying for property tax, who's paying for state tax, employment tax, off reservation. We could clarify all that, but we'd have to probably add to their software to get that information.
Yeah.
Commission and things like that. So we probably have to bring them to the table to get that information.
Yes. This could really go on. It could be a really great report.
It would be good if we can almost generate it yearly.
Uh-huh.
All these powers that be.
Sure.
Would see
that's why I think it'd almost be a good, you know, position. Like we've created the tourism position.
Right.
Why couldn't we create this one? Because it's going to be ongoing.
Mm-hmm.
I don't know what, you know, pot of money that would come out of at the state level, out of STEDS, but maybe it would be a new bill they bring in. If they want this information so bad to know how much we contribute, maybe. You know, then we can just identify somebody at each tribe to be responsible for meeting with that person.
Right.
Like we were responsible for meeting with, you know, Daniel when he comes to town. Mm-hmm. So you're working over at the college, huh?
Oh, yeah, it was.
Are you a professor?
In fact, they just came in and they wanted me to teach couple classes.
That's wonderful.
Agriculture and I mean, during this pandemic, I'm just kind of gearing down a little bit.
Yeah, that's great.
Yeah, I decided not to run for my re-election because I knew that pandemic was coming in.
Yeah.
And I figured maybe it's not the right time to be out there.
Exactly.
And then they were dealing with
it's everything. A touch screen.
There we go.
Touch.
Okay. We can hear you well now, Maria.
Okay, thanks.
Okay. So we'll move on to focus area three, partnerships. And this was the area that Ray and I worked on with Billy. And thank you, Billy, for keeping us in line. Focus area three was key partnerships and alliances. And this is one of the areas where we talked about, did I win?
Yep.
Yay! One! See, you guys should be here in person. You can win raffle prizes. Oh, I guess Cheryl already did.
Yes, yeah, so thank you. I didn't know that. So that's great.
Okay, so we had two goals. One was to create the inventory of relevant key partnerships and alliances. So we kind of brainstormed about what we had put together in our strategic planning, and we added to that. We really questioned who would be our good partners and why. And so some of the things we came up with, which we actually implemented today, was inviting elected officials like the mayor of, you know, the city that we are visiting. We did invite the legislator from Great Falls, Representative Lola Sheldon Galloway, but I guess she wasn't able to attend. But we would like to do that for all the places that we hold our meetings. And thank you, Billy, for doing that research on those legislators. And we also put in our strategic planning platform, the Mission Met, the Native American caucus in Montana. So currently we have 12 American Indian legislators, which is ties in with the population of natives in the state. So I don't know if you guys know this, but Montana has the largest number of Indian legislators in the nation. So that's something we really need to be proud of, and we really need to keep electing. So pat ourselves on the back. They can't hear me?
You might have to turn your volume up.
I'm not sure how to do that. I think it's right here.
Somebody and just so you know, I can hear you very good. Yeah.
Okay. You can hear?
Yes.
Shall we?
Yes, I can.
Okay. So, we've added our legislators, any elected officials. And you saw by our agenda today, we had Jason with the SBDC. And so if you guys have suggestions for any other partners that we could add, by all means, we're willing to do that in our next meeting. And then I guess our goal is to, you know, educate people about who we are as the SID Commission, but also to learn from them about what resources they bring to the table. So all of that information is in the strategy platform. And the one thing we talked about was holding community meetings in between our quarterly STED meetings. And so we tentatively planned one March 21st on my reservation. And this was not my suggestion. Just wanted to clarify that. Everybody wants to come to Flathead.
In March.
So I'm in the process of getting the conference space at the resort, potentially lunch sponsors, and a reduced hotel rate, because
ICE really doesn't have the budget for this. This was something that we just kind of dreamed up as another way to, I guess, inform people about our mission and, you know, what we're doing. So,
and tribal economic development issues.
Mm-hmm. So these are some of the partners in the packet that I have, or that we have before you, is, you know, some of our bankers, our legislators, our county commissioners, our chamber people. Mission West is a CDC, Arlia is a CDC. We have a tourism committee. We have six corporations, Salish Kootenai College. You know, there's just a lot of people that we could invite to inform what the STED Commission is and how it could work for them. So we would send out invitations to that in January. As always, offer a Zoom option, and then discuss an agenda at our next focus group meeting. So just so you guys are aware of that. Did I forget anything, Ray?
No, it's pretty good.
Can I add something?
Go ahead.
All right, so mute. This.
So I muted up here, but it's not muted.
Who knows iPad? Can somebody help her on the iPad? One of you. Okay, I'm just gonna talk, even though we're getting feedback over here. So this focus area two, keep partnerships and alliances. What we're really hoping is that STED, as STED members, you know, we want to move this around the state. And even though it might not be your reservation, we're hoping that you will come and support your fellow STED commissioner, in this case, you know, on CSKT, because as you can see, we're inviting all of these organizations are not tribal organizations. The intent is to educate them about CSKT and STED and what STED is doing across the state. So we're just hoping that you can help, you know, and support that. And if we come to Rocky Boy or Crow or Blackfeet, you know, we're hoping the same thing there, that the rest of the STED members can support that. I wonder if there's any questions.
Does anybody have any questions about that? Well, I'm excited to host everybody in March. So just keep that in mind, pencil it in, if you will. We'll pray for good weather, good traveling weather. If not, there's a Zoom option. So yeah, if you can think of any other potential partnerships, I think today was a really good example of, you know, some of the partnerships that we're trying to develop, the NADC, the Great Falls Small Business Development Center. I recently got an invitation from, I don't know if you guys remember Casey Lozar?
Yep.
He was, he had the job that Maria now holds. Well, he's with the Fed in Minneapolis right now. He's the vice president for the Center for Indian Country Development. And this office is virtually hosting an inaugural research summit December 9th and 10th. And this summit is going to bring together economic researchers and Indian country leaders and practitioners to discuss Indian country economic development research and policy. So they'll have one panel that focuses on the future of Indigenous economics research. whereby tribal leaders will discuss the research questions they would like to see addressed by Indigenous and non-Indigenous economic researchers. So Casey's invited me to sit on this panel by virtue of my position here. So if you guys have input into that, we could discuss that now as a in the sense of a potential partnership.
Can you put yourself on mute? So oops, you're still there. We go. I had asked Heather about their research group, if they could do this assessment, you know, if the Federal Reserve could do this assessment, and they said no. Yeah. So that's unfortunate. But the other thing is, if you know of anything in advance that you would need STED to help you with, like if they give you questions in advance, let us know.
Okay. So they will be doing that.
Yeah. Okay.
For focus area 3, we could move on to 4. So effectiveness of the commission, Gerald Gray.
We need a microphone.
Let's know if you can't hear Gerald when he starts talking. Give us a nod or something, a thumbs up. Sean, I can see you. Thumbs up if you can hear Gerald.
I can't hear Gerald. Can you guys hear me?
I can hear you, but I can't hear Gerald.
I can't hear those guys now. Marie, can you hear us? Maria, she can't hear us. I think we're having the same problem again.
For a second, because Sean can't hear you.
I can hear you guys now.
Can you hear him now?
I can't hear him. I can hear you. And Cheryl can't hear either.
Okay. Not sure why that phone isn't working, but
you guys can hear him though, huh?
Yeah, hold on. He's going to say something and give me a thumbs up if you can hear him. Sorry, Gerald. Gerald is talking about the process of nominating people. And so basically what the governor's office has told us is that the tribes just need to send either their appointments or their nominations to Gerald, right? Gerald, they can send them to you or they send them to us.
Send them to you guys.
Send them to us.
Yep.
So Billy, let's talk through the list. I don't see the list of who's missing. It's right down there. Okay. So Crow, Sean, can you get your tribe to nominate you again? Yep. Is that to me?
Yeah, I'll touch base with him.
And an alternate.
Alternate, all right.
Okay, so I think they can hear you now, Gerald. Maybe Northern Cheyenne, they're not on here.
Okay, so what I'll do is I'll reach out to the other four since Sean can do his, right?
Fort Belknap's here, you guys would do the same thing.
Yep.
And then Fort Peck is.
So Ray, do you
try to send me something saying they nominate you as an alternate?
You'll do it, oh, perfect.
And should we have it set a deadline, Gerald?
Yeah, definitely. We could try to get this done in at least a couple weeks at the longest.
What is that? I know Ray works off the deadline really well.
Perfect. Try to shoot for like December 3rd.
December 3rd. Sean, can you meet that deadline December 3rd?
Sean, can you meet the December 3rd deadline?
If I can catch up with him, I could probably do it.
Yeah.
Say that again.
Maybe we should do it for the end of December. That way, might see him every now and then. But once I see him, I can let him know.
Well, let's keep that deadline and then just work really hard to do it so that we have you officially by the February meeting.
Can he, is it possible, instead of sending a letter, can he just text you?
Yeah. Can he?
Text him verbally, yes. Tell you? Let's say I see him at a meeting, and instead of his assistant trying to type a letter and communicate and do all those processes, I can get him on the phone, and can he verbally just inform you?
Yes.
With the phone.
Yeah.
I think that would be a lot easier because I believe that he's really stressed and under a lot of, has a lot of irons in the fire kind of thing.
And keep in mind, we need an alternate too, Sean. So it'd be you and somebody else.
All right, I'll look around for one, and I'll express a few alternates and see if he has somebody in mind, or I'll figure that out when I see him.
Okay.
I'll try to see.
Somebody know that they know something about economic development.
Yeah.
Okay. Thank you.
A quick note before we get too far. That
I'm muting again.
Can you hear me, Marie?
Okay. All right, so moving on to goal B, basically just implementing a regular process of updating and measuring and following through on this strategic plan. I guess the action items would be reviewing it at each quarterly meeting. I don't know if we want to review the whole thing, but what's needed.
What we're doing right now.
Yeah, yep. And then these focus areas, so that's on there. Goal C is documenting and implementing a regular calendar and process for ensuring effective commission meetings. So that would be integrating team building and everyone likes food oriented activities into the meetings. Yeah, we missed breakfast. No. and then adopting a commission meeting calendar, which would be really good, I think, in terms of, so we all have it. There it is, right there.
And then packets. Oh, okay. And can we talk about that for a minute?
Yep.
Put yourself on mute. So in your packet, or I think online, Billy included the fiscal year 21 calendar. So you can see our next February 16th of 2022. And is this on our calendars yet?
No.
So this will be put on our calendar after this meeting. Somebody needs to mute. But I think what we need to talk about is
what we plan for at the Office of Indian Country is to have the February meeting in Helena, have the May meeting in Billings. But if you guys feel strongly to move these to Indian Country, that's what we need to talk about today so that we can, you know, make those plans. Where would it be? What are the accommodations? Where would everybody stay? Like next time, if we come to Great Falls, we'll use Little Shell. We'll use Little Shell facilities. We'll, you know, all of that. But with the February meeting, I guess the number one question is, are you okay with having it in Helena in February, or do you want to move it somewhere in Indian Country? That's the question on the table right now. I'm going to take myself off of mute.
Thoughts from the commissioners?
I would like to see it in Indian Country, but I understand that some of the tribes are unable to host, you know, due to accommodations mostly. Food's definitely not a problem, but
yeah.
So
it's just the hotels.
And like Richard. But we could always stay and have them go out to Rocky Boy, right?
I have no.
With Sean, a good long drive. And by myself, I'd like to have it in Indian Country for Indian businesses. Possible, I know some of our other boards that's what I sit on.
So anybody want to just put their neck out there and say February, this is where we want to meet? I mean, those of you who are in the room, we could ask Lane, who's not on the call, but anybody here want to say volunteer your place for February? Now keep in mind February, what the roads are going to be like. So
yeah, that's not a good time for black feet. So
yeah,
we'll have to pass.
Thank you, Cheryl.
Blowing away or being covered by snow.
yeah, we'd all be stuck. Yeah. Are you guys okay for Helena in February? Or do you want to go to, we got Rocky Boy here, we got Fort Belknap, we got CSKT, Little Shell. We don't have the other tribes on besides Cheryl. So we know it's not gonna be Blackfeet. Going once, going twice. Helena's fine with you?
Helena's fine with me as well. I probably would be doing a Zoom meeting anyway.
Yeah.
Yeah, we still have COVID restrictions. So Helena's good for me in February.
Okay. Okay. All right, so Helena it is. And we're gonna have to have this discussion at the next meeting for the May meeting. You know, so maybe May will be a little bit better to go somewhere else that's, you know, a little bit more easier to get to. All right, Sean said he's good with Helena. Okay. Okay, good. Okay. Yeah. Well, even better. Okay, I'm gonna go on mute, Gerald.
So the last goal D is the revision of House Bill 670. That's working with the department, governor's office, and the legislature to update the STED statute and House Bill 670. And that's to be determined in terms of an action item. That's it. Goal D.
D is in David.
D is in dog. We don't go David.
Why can't I remember what that is? Oh.
Okay, you're on mute. All right.
You did talk about it a little bit when you talked about you and Missy going to strike.
Yeah, but this is House Bill 670 is actually STED's STED statute. Mm-hmm. And we said that we probably needed to update it. That's part of the red tape review. So the governor's office is doing what they're calling a red tape review, where they're looking at commissions and statutes and all of that, and wanting to make sure that they're updated. Do we really need them? Those kind of things. And so we actually did look at this, the STED statute, and it was updated. You know, the original one that we looked at back in, what was it, 1999? That one has been updated. And I'm not sure that it's in the packet right now, Billy, is it? Because the original statute, like the Director of Indian Affairs, back then it used to be called the Coordinator of Indian Affairs, if you guys remember that. you know, so it had old names in it and it had just a lot of old information. Like it said that we would, there would be a grant writer, that there would be a couple positions that were never hired. And so I think what this group has to do is just look at that again and just make sure that we have all of the updated language. But we did review it for the red tape review. I just think we need to take another look at it. Yep.
Okay. Billy, can you,
yeah.
What happened to it when, say, the grant writer didn't materialize as a funding issue, or what was the reason that that didn't happen?
That's a good question.
Now that we're around?
Oh.
Yeah.
Stead never had a home until the Department of Commerce took the sun under the wing.
Yeah.
Oh. So I think that there's just a lot of loose ends that haven't ever been really functionally executed. So I think there's a lot to be done here. I mean, from my standpoint,
you know, as we look at the red tape review process, you know, we have 10 attached boards in commerce, and, you know, we're evaluating every single one of them to be able to say is, you know, plus Stead Commission and some other commissions that we're involved with, are they effective? Are they creating, you know, executable, are they executing and creating results? And, you know, we have to be, you know, I think very introspective and willing to look at the goods, the bads, the uglies of what we're doing and be able to say, what do we need to do to make this an impactful group? And part of that might be that, hey, we haven't had a grant writer and someone that could come alongside some of the tribes to be able to work with them. Yes, you have NAVAs, you have all this other kinds of stuff, but you can't necessarily do everything. And then also to have a little bit more coordination. I know that Maria and Billy and Dan and Luke have been trying to start to do that and become more involved and more invested. But it's now the investments being made, but now where do we move from being invested to being effective? And that's the transition that I would like to see us be able to make and to hold ourselves accountable in this commission to be able to say, okay, what's our measurement of effectiveness for what we're doing? I mean, what does being effective look like? I mean, we can have a meeting and we can turn around and say, oh, well, Department of Commerce gave out these grants, but what does this group hold itself to be accountable for effectiveness? How do we want to be measured as to whether, and that's what the governor's going to look at, is how do we want to be measured so that we can represent to him, here's where we started, here's where we're at today, here's where we're going. So that would be my encouragement.
I'm going to add to that. I hope you guys heard Director Osterman on the line pretty well. I think that we're headed in that direction with this strategic plan, because if you think of what we're doing around Focus Area 1 with the funding, Focus Area 2 with the partnerships, with the assessments, Focus Area 3 with the partnerships. I mean, we're gonna be able to say, you know, Stead partnered with NADC to do this planning grant and then this implementation grant. That's bringing dollars into the tribes to do X. Yes, and you know, we're just starting it, right? We're just baby step number one. But I think a year from now, we're gonna have a lot of accomplishments to say how Stead is being effective. As long as we have your guys, you know, everybody that's on the Stead, your engagement, and that, you know, you come to these meetings and you're engaged and doing our bi-weekly meetings, you know, with the focus areas, and that everybody is staying engaged. You know, because this is for the tribes across the state. So that's my two cents.
Okay, thank you for that report. Maria, did we already cover the last agenda item, the old business, the Beebe report and the tribal resolution template?
Yeah, except I'm not keeping myself up on mute, but I just want to talk about what are we going to do with that tribal resolution? Are we going to handle that in the next meeting of the next assessment meeting? You know, to give everybody direction on what to do with it.
Is there any comments from commissioners? Go ahead, Richard.
I have a comment. Probably some additional information that I didn't read. How much is it going to cost? You talk about a contribution from the tribe. How much does each tribe have to contribute to, you know, just some numbers to back us up. If we're able to get that, then I present to the business committee, because first thing they always ask, how much is it going to cost? Where can we get the money? So if I could show on paper how much it's going to cost them, and what our end product will look like. Probably an easy sell for me.
Mm-hmm. Okay.
I'm going to put yourself on mute for a second. Yeah, I think focus area two with Shelley, it's you and Ray, right? Or no, sorry, two. Oh, Cheryl and Sean. On our next meeting, we'll put that should be on the agenda to talk about. Going to BBER, like we said earlier, and have them give us a plan of what it would cost to finish this report. And kind of like what Director Osterman was saying, the Cadillac version versus the Fiat version or whatever, and everything in between. And then we can maybe bring that back to STED to say, here's what BBER said it would cost. If we divide that by eight tribes, this is what it would, you know, this is what it would cost you. So we'll handle that in the next focus area two, which is Cheryl and Sean are responsible for that. And I'm going to go off mute so that.
And since Cheryl and Sean are both U of M alumni, they should be able to strike us a good deal. Just kidding.
See what I can do.
I was under the impression that we're using this tribal letterhead to actually get the audits, because the clearinghouse doesn't account for a lot of the numbers that's needed for the report. So we can, you know, while we're waiting for a quote from University of Montana, we could be utilizing that to gather our audits, from what I understand, because they're using FY 18 and 19. To begin with.
What, 18 and
If you say that these are annual audits that are turned in to the feds, obviously, but is there a particular cadence? When does it have to happen, by August 1st for the previous fiscal year or functional year? Or is there a deadline that's universal for all of the tribes as to when this happened? Or is it just...
It's a yearly audit, but it varies. Right? Some of the extensions and...
Okay, so it could be all over. All right.
This pandemic, they extended four months.
Okay.
From the March deadline.
Okay. So it's variable, right? Yeah. So the soonest that we would have 2020 would be, or would 2020 be done?
Ours will.
Okay.
I think we had one time that was done. I think we recorded.
Okay.
Yeah.
Yeah. Yours are done. Okay. So start.
Can I say something here, which means everybody has to go off the mute? I'm so all of this. I guess, you know, if Ray was to go to Fort Belknap Council and say, with this resolution in hand, and say, you know, I'm part of STED and we're asking you guys to make your data available to BBER, I think we all need to be on the same page of the years. What year are we asking? What years are we asking? And since it doesn't say that in House Bill, it just says starting in 2020, you know, we don't have that direction. So do we just say that ourselves? Do we just say, here's the data we're gonna ask for? Because we all have to be on the same page. Because if you go and they only give us 18 and 19 and CSKT has 19 and 20 and Little Shell has 20, you know what I mean? It's still not getting us what we need. So that's why I'm hesitating that anybody takes this resolution right now, because we haven't defined the time frame.
Well, who, so the question.
Should we take an action to at least agree to a time frame here and present it? Mm-hmm. Or do we want to wait on? Because you'll have to wait to get an official answer over a year for the legislature to define it. So I guess that would be my question. Do we want to take an action and say, this is our recommendation as STED, that this is the years that we adopt and the anniversary date of how the decennial report, if it was put together in 2019 and it's going to begin in 2020, according to those documents, then, you know, there's two questions. Do you just do 2020 as a slice in time, or do you take whatever information you have that leads up to 2020 for 2 or 3 years to at least start a trend? Or, I mean, there's all sorts of ways to interpret it, but I think if we don't make a recommendation as to how you want to go forward and interpret it, the tribes aren't going to be able to understand what they need to do, and it's going to be a cluster, and we're going to be right back where we were a year from now asking the same questions. So maybe we should make a recommendation and make a decision. Don't have to necessarily do it right now, but sooner than later, to be able to take an action as a resolution from STED to go out and say, this is what we see, we believe needs to happen, and our recommendation, yeah. And then get feedback.
Chairwoman Fine, I think Sean is trying to talk. He's on mute.
Go ahead, Sean.
Yeah, one quick note, and maybe Cheryl can he manages her federal programs up there too, but when I'm managing all these federal programs, when I'm within the executive branch, so let's say, for example, when you're dealing with your fiscal year 2021, during the winter, the auditor would come and get all the financial information to do the audit. And then the auditor would provide the information back sometime anywhere from May to June. And then that information would be submitted to the tribe, and the funding agent would be the 638, whether it's an Indian Health Service contract or it might be the Bureau of Indian Affairs. And so based on that, we could essentially be ahead of the curve right when the tribe receives the audit information in May or June, unless they're late. The tribe, they themselves are late. So that could be, we could, if we have buy-in from the tribe, we can receive that information early, but before it goes to the clearinghouse, which would be a year later. So we could essentially try to get that information early if the tribe is willing to. Right when the tribe gets it, right when the federal agency gets it, we can get it. But it depends if the tribe's willing to release information before it hits the Freedom of Information Act, which is 2 years later.
Right. And the other option I think I want to put on the table here is that we can look at what the last report was dated, the data from the last report that Commerce funded. And, you know, I want to say it was 2012, but I'm not positive.
It runs through 2009.
Oh, two, three. Okay, so from 10 to 20, right? If we said all of the tribes in this resolution, we'd like to have data from 2010 to 2020, there you go. Yeah.
I like that option merely because 2020 brought us the CARES Act funding, and I think that would be reflected in that past year. And we all should have our audits from 10 years ago, right?
Except Gerald.
Oh, except Wilson. Yeah.
But, well,
we got to go
separate. We need to start. I mean, we would know that, you mm-hmm. know. Because this information
is going to be, it's not individual tribe, it's all compiled together. So, okay, do we need to make a resolution of that or our motion?
Like that motion.
Second. Okay, we have a motion by Richard, second by Director Osterman to designate 2010 to 2020 as the period of our decennial report.
Yep.
For the
data that we're going to ask the tribes through the resolution, right?
Yes.
But so we should ask the.
Go ahead.
So ask the. Should we go now? Like, we could prepare a resolution. How do you guys want us to handle this resolution? You do your own resolutions, take it to your own tribal council, ask them for all of the data between 2010 and 2020. And then Sean and Cheryl, who run Focus Area 2, will figure out the specifics with BBR, what it's going to cost, and then come back. Does that make sense to you guys? Because everybody has to ask for the same information.
I think if we just add in that fifth whereas require decennial report on economic impact was signed into law, maybe not there, but if we put the data, the years in the report, because our resolutions are a little bit different format, but if we just specify excuse me, 2010 to 2020, I think we're good.
So we could do that and maybe email it out to all of the commissioners.
Perfect.
And then you guys take it to your council. Are you want to say this
online?
Billy will.
Okay, so we have a motion and a second. All those in favor?
Aye.
Aye. Opposed?
Aye.
Motion carries. Unanimous. Awesome. Go ahead, Cheryl.
Oh no, I just said aye. That's fine. That's good. 10 to 10:20. We're one of the tribes that's behind right now, so hopefully, you know, that it'll be up through 2020 when we need this. Thanks.
I believe the Crow Tribe is behind too.
But again, we can also use unaudited financial statements, you know, with my background, I could work with BBER and help them with what they need from this, our audits, unaudited statements if needed. Hello, we can't hear you.
Sorry. I'm concerned that does the resolution spell out specifically to the tribes what data we are looking for? You know, because what it's not going to be helpful if the tribes give different data. You know what? Let's handle this in focus area two. We can talk to BBER and have them spell it out. Okay. Okay. All right, let's do that.
Okay, so we'll have the staff send out the revised resolution template. And meanwhile, Cheryl and Sean will work on focus area two with Bieber. So with that, I think that concludes our agenda. So motion by Gerald to adjourn.
I'm sorry, this is Cheryl. I just had one comment.
Second by Richard. Yeah. All those in favor.
Thank you so much.
All right. Thank you, guys. This was a great meeting. Thank you for everyone's participation and involvement in the focus groups, especially. And safe travels.
Cheryl and Sean, thank you for hanging in there with us. I know that's hard on an all-day Zoom call.
And sure.
We'll see you in Helena in February.
Okay.
Tracy, nice meeting you. And Sean, we need you to be in Helena in February.
But, you know, if this acting career takes off, I'm not sure if I have to.
Yeah.
That made me a big chief in that movie.
Yeah. Yeah.
You guys wouldn't even notice me. I look like Chief Dan George out there.
All right. We'll put it on your calendar, February.
All right. I'll tell my agent.
Yeah, tell your agent. You need to be with us.
My own kind. Yeah. All right.
All right. Take care, everyone. Bye-bye.
Bye.
Bye. Bye.
Hold on, Bill.